All right, so students, Mr. Thangavelu is an expert in the design of complex space projects, including space stations and exploratory missions. He's a graduate lecturer at the University of Southern California. He holds a master's and bachelor's in engineering, and he also mentors students in a variety of different parts of engineering and astronaut, aerospace engineering, et cetera. Mr. Thangavelu, am I saying your name right?
Pretty good.
Pretty good. How do you say it?
Thangavelu.
Okay. I tried my hardest.
You know, you're doing very well, Nicole.
Thank you very much. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you. Let me know when the slides come through. Are you able to see my screen?
I'll let you know. I can't see yet. Is it allowing, are you able to hit the share screen button?
That's what I'm missing.
Let me allow, it says all participants who can start sharing. Let me change that permission and see if you can share now.
How does that look?
I don't see them. Do any of the students, can any of you see the
screen yet?
No, no one can see it. Maybe click off and click back on, because sometimes it takes a few seconds for the permissions to change.
Let me try.
Okay, something's happening. It's allowing you to share. But it is not showing me. Do you have the green button at the bottom?
Not yet.
Interesting. Do you want to pop off and pop back on?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see if that works. Hang on, students. We'll get there.
Share screen.
Oh, it's there.
Well, that's not the one. That's
not but at least it's sharing.
There you go. How does that look?
I see humans on Mars, past, present, and future.
The important thing is, does it say Mars Society, Nicole?
No.
What does it say?
It says AA Symposium.
Yeah, that's not the one. Wait, 1 minute.
Okay.
Now, what does it show?
Hold on, it's not there yet. Nothing sharing. Is it sharing on your end?
Hold on just a minute now.
Okay. Okay, something's coming. I see it. It's tiny, so I can't see if it says the Mars Society or not.
Coming up.
Aha, perfect. You're up. Go for it. Thank you.
Okay. Good afternoon from Southern California. Boys and girls, I think I'm addressing high school students. I'm delighted to talk to you about our common vision, which is to engage directly with the rest of our solar system in general, engage directly, physically in the cosmos. And there are reasons for doing this, which I will get into. My name is Madhu Thangavelu, and I conduct the graduate studio in astronautical engineering within the Viterbi School of Engineering at the University of Southern California. I also happen to have a degree in architecture, as in civil architecture, and I teach space architecture in the Graduate School of Architecture at USC. Now, USC has an astronautical engineering program. It is very different in curriculum than the aerospace engineering program that permeates around the world that all of you are familiar with. Our curriculum is focused on spacecraft. And within it, within it is our studio. Now, I want to first of all remind you, there are some incredible things happening today and in the coming days. The most important thing in our corner here is the International Moon Day. Now, you're wondering, why am I talking about the moon when it's a Mars event? But I'm quite engaged in some of these activities. So the International Moon Day is set for July 20th of this month. It is the inaugural International Moon Day, sponsored by the United Nations. And I happen to be part of the group that's working on this. Why do I say that? Because Neil Armstrong was our student at USC, and the moon is very special to USC. So is Mars. Now, what is my class about? The studio is all about unbridled imagination. I want each of you to think new things. If you come up with other people's ideas, not work in my class. So then we send those folks off to USC football or something like that. But for those who want to have creative, original visions of what we intend to do, what humanity intends to do in space, and for Earth, we want you in my class. Of course, you'll go through bachelor's and then master's and then get into doctorate programs, and then you'll end up in my class. So it's about concept creation and rapidly dreaming up what you think could be the future of humans in space and on other planets. It is completely independent of agency, NASA, European Space Agency, wishes, because many of them think in committees. I want you to think about what you can do as an individual. My studio usually holds 10 or 15 students, and our reviewers include people who walked on the moon. Buzz Aldrin is a favorite. He comes incognito, and as you can see, this is one of our classes. We have one of our final presentations. You got doctors, lawyers, engineers, cinematographers, private company, aerospace companies, students who have graduated and gone on to companies in both the prime contractors and private space industry like SpaceX. So that happens in the fall. In the spring, I teach in the School of Architecture, where the people have their nose to the ground. I mean, they're thinking about what is happening in the world today, this moment, they want to engage space activities in things happening on planet Earth. They ask me, why do you go out into space when there are so many problems on planet Earth? So it is my duty, it is our duty to tell them that space is integral to what is happening on Earth. And we can live better lives, cleaner lives, efficient lives with minimal footprint on our ecologies if we do things in space. So what are we pondering? We are pondering the world, what happens in 2050. There's probably already lots of things happening on the moon. What are the implications for people on Earth? It's very important. Architects are thinking that. What is the philosophy of a spacefaring civilization? All this leads to our area of interest and expertise called space architecture. What is space architecture? It's about space habitats. It's about alien environments, how to live there. It is very interdisciplinary. If you think as an engineer, you can go out and do everything, no, you can do much better if you have doctors and lawyers and academicians and artists with you and musicians with you. So we involve everybody in this endeavor. And you want to go look at our archive to see what our students, many of them are from the military, from the DOD and different forces. They know how to accomplish a mission. So our topics are devoted to that kind of thing. Take a look at our site when you get a chance, ASTE527 USC. Click on Google, go and enjoy those slides. Many of these ideas come to us from the books that we have published in the past, including The Moon. It is a classic. It's a 5-star classic on Amazon. And I would love for each of you to get a copy. Take a look at what we think the future holds. Stepping Stone Moon to Mars. Buzz Aldrin wrote the foreword, and he comes to class. When he does, we get some of our books signed by him. He's a fantastic champion for human space flight. So let's delve right into our topic, which is about the past and focused on Mars. It's mostly about imagination and interesting things. It goes back to Jonathan Swift talking about the satellites of Mars, and then Asaph Hall and his wife Stickney, who pushed him to look out towards the satellites of Mars. And you have people like Schiaparelli talking about the possibility at that time that there may be living things on Mars. And Percival Lovell, who started to imagine canals on Mars. And then comes our own H.G. Wells from the United States. He was quite a character, and he produced a show that you can go and listen to on YouTube, which stunned the audience. They were new to radio. They were listening to the radio when he talked about Martians landing on Earth and causing havoc. And guess what? It sent the public crazy. They were all over the place wondering what the heck is going on till he announced it was just a radio show. Of course, there are many books written on the topics, which I'm sure all of you have read. Then comes the time, 1938, when Orson Welles presents this thing on radio about War of the Worlds. And as I mentioned, it caused havoc among the people of the United States. Then more recently, we look at people like Ray Bradbury, was a good friend. You know, we used to go listen to him here in Los Angeles, and quite a storyteller. If you haven't read Fahrenheit 451, recommend it. And of course, the Martian Chronicles. Then come, we are moving fast in kind of a chronological order to the present. So from those imaginary ideas, we are moving to something about realism and realities. I think things started to go real when the Second World War ended, and we brought home a large number of people from Germany who were involved with the Nazi program, particularly the rocket programs. And you will see here Werner von Braun and some of his colleagues were all instrumental in establishing the human spaceflight program for civilian purposes in the United States. He went on to Werner von Braun. Walt Disney very quickly understood the imaginative aspects of human spaceflight and took on Werner von Braun's idea of establishing humanity across the cosmos, Mars first. And they went on to really promote human spaceflight. These are some of the books that may still be available to you if you go into your libraries, or perhaps find a way to see their digital versions. Our friend here is a producer of movies, and he has done a fantastic new documentary on Chesley Bonestell, who painted all the vistas of the solar system, Moon, Mars, Saturn, and so on. Spectacular visions, all happening in the early 1950s. And Doug, our neighbor, is putting up this movie about Chesley Bonestell for the International Moon Day program. It is available to you to watch it free during a course of a week or two, I think. I just saw an email from Doug. He said, everything is set for the International Moon Day. You must watch it. It's a must for all of you. These are some of the views, the beautiful views of Chesley Bonestell about Mars. Then we move on to become real. How do we go to Mars? Very early on, we realized that if we want to go quickly, we cannot use regular normal propulsion systems. We need to go nuclear. So if you remember, 1940s is when the nuclear revolution happened, and then we started using it for civilian purposes. And NASA, under the NERVA rover program, had tested many of these. From smaller ones to bigger ones, they tested every one of them. So in the 60s, we had the capabilities to fly off to Mars very fast using nuclear propulsion. These are some of the tests that were done. Testing to the limit, testing to the ultimate failure limits were all done. And then come the 1960s, when artists, movie producers, and technical expertise ganged together and produced a movie called 2001, A Space Odyssey. It gives me goose pimples when I still see these visuals, because they really depicted the power of humanity to break the bonds of Earth and go off to places never visited before. And 2001 was written by our good friend Arthur Clarke, who happened to be the chancellor of the International Space University while I was graduating. He read my thesis and had some incredible things to say about it. So it became a beautiful thing to think about going out to space, to the moon, Mars, and beyond. These are some of the visuals that came across because there was tremendous technical expertise and coordination between NASA scientists and the film industry to make this as real and as credible as possible. I love to visit these models whenever I get a chance. This was at the National Space Society event 2 years ago. You see the Discovery vehicle and the lander. So we come to 1968, things are happening. We became real. It was not an imagination anymore. We went to the moon, and this is a photograph that was sent back. It was on the cover of every newspaper around the world, including the New York Times, Life magazine, and so on, an image by Bill Anders. And that really changed the way we look at ourselves. We look at our place in the cosmos. Norman Cousins mentioned this in a key way. He said that going to the moon changed us, not because we went to another extraterrestrial place, but we looked back at planet Earth for the first time. And every astronaut or every person you see will tell you, once you fly out and you come back, you are a changed person. You are not an American or a Russian or a Chinese person. You are a human being. And that's the realization that Frank White talks about in another book called The Overview Effect. So you want to look at that book too. Again, 1968 is a seminal year for us all, because there was another guru of sorts. His name was Buckminster Fuller. He put out a little book that is again available to you freely. Take a look at it, Operating Manual for Spaceship Earth. You'll see in there that he talks about the future. And he says, why do we have to go into space? We live on a spaceship, and it's called Spaceship Earth. That's the first time the bell rang and all of us saying that, hey, wait a minute, we got to take care of our environment because we live with finite resources. There you go. And before you know it, 1969 comes along and you see Neil Armstrong, or alumnus from USC, joined with MIT alumnus Buzz Aldrin on the moon. And as you know, Neil came to school and offered the commencement address, I think 2005. We had a great time. He mentioned something very interesting. You can get the commencement speech on Google. He says in it, that don't, now that you have understood everything, he's telling the students, now that you understand engineering, don't think that everything happens by logic. You have to go beyond it to do the real things in life. Soon after, before you know it, 20 years later, we are right here on station, which is orbiting us right now. And also, and during the 90s, while President Clinton was in the White House, McKay and group looked at some meteorite fragments and located some interesting thoughts, and that suggested maybe Mars had life in it. And they were able to pull out what appeared to be microfossils. And that is the debate that we are about to solve. So this is a very interesting time we live in. In the coming years, we'll know if we are unique in the cosmos or whether life percolates all over the cosmos. And that question has ramifications for everything we do. So I want to talk to you a little bit about space philosophy. What is space philosophy? It's like yin and yang. There's a lot of stuff going on in there. it is important because philosophy is the foundation on which we build our beautiful superstructures of any idea. So philosophy begins with the question, the deep questions of why, what are we doing, why are we here, and so on. So in the start of any mission, in the start of any project, it is important to think about why we are doing what we are doing. You probably read Jeff Bezos' Amazon First Day Letter. It's all about why. And there are many people like Simon Sinek who talks about why we do some things to generate a cohesive interest and build consensus among a wide group of people before we attempt to do very complex projects like space missions. And space missions are complex. So are many other things we do. So some of the philosophies today include Elon Musk, who says we have to settle other planets because human survival is at stake. If something happens to Earth, we need to move our consciousness, our spirits to other places where we can thrive, survive and thrive. Jeff Bezos takes another angle, which says planet Earth, so far as we know, is unique. We must preserve it, we must protect it, and must make our species thrive in it, not just polluted and mess it up. John Marburger III was our dean of arts and letters at USC. And he mentioned in the Goddard Memorial Lecture some years ago, again, something you can find on Google, that our task in the space arena is to bring the entire solar system into our economic sphere of influence. Interesting idea. Joseph Campbell, the guru behind Star Wars and George Lucas philosophy, he said that he had an angle which said, you know, when you go out into Mars, when you go out into space to Moon, Mars, and so on, what you do as a human is come back and tell the story. And this is what Buzz Aldrin does. Every day he's going out and saying, you know, we look back on Earth, precious place to be, and so on. So Freeman Dyson, who some of you may know, he said something else. He said, you look out into space, look out in the darkness of the cosmos, everything seems cold and dark. And maybe one of the reasons for our existence is to get out there and beautify this dark, cold place we call the cosmos. Frank White, as I mentioned before, he mentions that when you go out, look at planet Earth, you start to see how fragile the blue planet is. And, you know, I think Carl Sagan says the same thing. So astronauts are changed people. Wish millions of us, wish all of you, all of us could go out and have that experience. As you know, the Star Trek star, William Shatner, went up on Jeff Bezos' rocket ship the other day, came back and said, you look down, you see Earth full of life. You look up, it is all black and death. Some ways it reflects on what space is about. And more recently, the NSS president, Michelle Hanlon here, she said that we have to preserve our humanity's cultural heritage in space and on extraterrestrial surfaces. I think it's an excellent idea because 1,000 years from now, people will want to know what it's all about. So now, let's look a little bit at the future. So now that you've kind of cut into various angles of the philosophy. Let's see what's happening. I like to say the future is always now. We build the future. Again, Neil Armstrong, in his commencement address at USC 2005, he said, it is our duty to enable the future. All of you are enablers of the future. Many of us may not create it, but as the computer guru once said, the future is yours to create. Agreed, but I think all of us need to enable it. Now, in the now period, as you know, we've been flying stuff to Mars, and this is an image of the Perseverance rover, our most advanced rover, which is roving Mars right now. It's full of beautiful little payloads. And the one that is interesting to many of us is called Moxie. I think I have an image of it. The idea is, I'll come to this a little bit later, but Mars is not habitable, simply not habitable now. But you know what? We can take the atmosphere, which is toxic, which is carbon dioxide, and turn it into what we breathe and live, oxygen. You can split carbon dioxide and make oxygen. You can then start thinking about a new kind of life, new kind of living. So ideally, we would like to have 300 foot tall structures that generate oxygen for breaking up carbon dioxide. But in reality, right now, we are set with a 1 foot tall Moxie experiment on Perseverance, which is performing. So what about Mars? Let me tell you a few things about Mars, not to discourage you, but to give it some thought, because at least there are two kinds of professionals that we deal with in the space program. One we call visioneers, and the other we call mission designers. We should not mix them together, because mission designers are forced to accept the fact that you're going to put people on a spacecraft, you're going to fly them. Their safety, their well-being, and their psyche are the most important part of the mission, not any other object. So let me tell you a little bit about Mars that concerns all of you. It's waiting for humans in many ways, because it's got a day comparable to Earth. It's got an atmosphere, and it's not too far away from the sun like the rest of the other larger planet. It's got two satellites. For some years, they were talking about going to the satellite of Mars rather than landing on Mars, because it's much easier to do. Now, if you're an orbital dynamicist, you will very quickly see that Mars is a highly eccentric orbit. And that means the seasons on Mars can be extreme, and it is. It is extreme. So this causes a great deal of difficulties. We have moved away from the sun, further out from Earth. It's cooler. And this is how it looks through the years. Sometimes you see deposits on the polar regions. And sometimes you don't see anything on the face of Mars. If you have a small telescope, you can see this. Sometimes you can delineate landforms, and sometimes they're completely blurred because of dust storms. And dust storms, because of the extreme climate, can last for years. That's what dust does to your vehicles. So what are the challenges? Gravity is low, 3/8 of Earth's gravity. lack of a protective magnetosphere. Magnetospheres help us on Earth by keeping the harsh radiation of the sun away from us. It deflects it through the magnetic fields. Mars does not have one. It has a negligible one. It's very toxic, extremely thin, pure carbon dioxide atmosphere. The soil is toxic. Climate, as I mentioned, is extreme. There is dust, and it always appears to be twilight when the sun is up, because we are further away from the sun than the Earth. So what are we doing about artificial gravity? That is a misnomer. There is no such thing as artificial gravity. But we can simulate weight by spinning our vehicle around, so you get a centripetal acceleration and centrifugal force that compares to weight. And by rotating faster or slower, we can make ourselves feel heavier or lighter. Such an idea was put out. Many, many, many people have thought about it. This is my own idea about how we could have done it during the last years of the space shuttle, where you could have spun the space shuttle with the space habitat on there and simulate weight. So remember that there is no such thing as artificial gravity. There's artificial weight. We went on to work on different ideas for how we could carry people in a regular condition, because we know when we put astronauts into space in free fall, in what we call zero gravity environments, our bones start shedding calcium, they become feeble, our heart messes up, our eyes mess up. So we need some kind of method to make people have that strength of body musculature. USC has studied some ideas on how we could do that by rotating the vehicle. And radiation is a big problem. The magnetosphere shields us from the harsh radiation of the sun. We need to do that on vehicles heading to Mars. There are some new ideas out there, and I know that NASA is pursuing them. Radiation is a big problem, so you need to study that. And we know that going to Mars entails a transitory period of 6 months, which is not a good thing. It has effects on all kinds of blood-forming organs. And here is some visions of Mars during the daytime. It's not very bright. And during twilight, it looks like that. So the magnetotail, the magnetosphere, there are some studies out of NASA, particularly Jim Green, has been saying that we could generate a force that could then create a magnetic field for Mars. And I think he's doing some very new things too about it. So in my opinion, I hate to say this, if planet Venus is Dante's hell, I would compare Mars to purgatory, because Earth is so beautiful. Oh, we are evolved here. We were born, live and die on planet Earth. Our bodies and our spirit lives on Earth. But we will eventually go out and take part in the rest of the solar system. So welcome to Mars. No protective magnetosphere, pure carbon dioxide atmosphere at extremely low pressure, extreme weather, and long-lasting dust storms, dim sunlight, heavy radiation on the surface, and toxic soil. We have to learn how to do it. Now, you may want to look at this. It's called commensal bacteria. It's important because if you want to grow food, you want to look at the planet. And look at how plants grow. Plants carry their own bacteria from their seed stock all the way to growth. On Earth, we don't think about it much because they're all in the soil, but there is none on Mars or the Moon. So we need to prepare the soil to make food on these places. It seems there are ways to make food from thin air on Earth. And I know that Solar Foods got some good grants recently, so think about that. So some ideas about Mars. If you went there, what would you do? My own favorite place is to go here, visit this part here with the most, the tallest volcanoes in the known solar system. And the longest looking canyons, very dramatic place to visit, not to live. So we want to be able to go very fast if you want to do this. And my own feeling is, if we have a vehicle, dreaming again, if you have a vehicle that can take you with a 1G acceleration all the time, you'll feel at home because you don't have to spin and so on. It'll be a very quick transit, very, very quick transit. You can go for a holiday on Mars and come back. But the current problem is our physics says it's going to take a huge amount of fuel to do this. So, but think about it. We're thinking about how to do this. So I think for me, I may be old, but I like the idea of Mars tours. I'd go to Mars, spend a week, look at all those beautiful places and come back. And these are studies, we've studied them since the 60s and the 70s. NASA has been looking at various possibilities using nuclear shuttles, as you see here, and going very fast. But we want to go really much, much, much faster. How do you prevent radiation even during the short transit? We're already working on things that prevent radiation on crew. You Google STEMRAD and you'll see what we are doing on station. These are the earlier images of nuclear shuttles, nuclear vehicles on transit to Mars. And this is the latest. This is the latest. How are we doing in time? Good. The idea again is to make a fast transit, get to your destination, and then do the things you want to do and come back quickly and safely. Now, people don't tell you much, but Elon Musk and others are using Starship to fly out. But we need to have creature comforts. Our school has studied the possibility of 3D printing delicious food in orbit and in transit. This is what real food looks like. It's not what astronauts eat now. And in longer duration missions, the person who makes the best food is highly regarded. In the Antarctica or in space station or on submarines, anybody who can get creative with food naturally gravitates to become the leader. And these are things that architects understand a lot better than engineers. Do you know what this is? You won't believe it, but there was a time before, regular transits of airplanes happened between the continents. There was a time when there were very large airships. You're looking at the interior of the Hindenburg before disaster struck. There was a piano room, there was a dining room, libraries. These were very large and highly ornamented vehicles that took the creme de la creme, intelligentsia, the top captains of commerce. They're all on these ships plying the continents. That is how we want to go. Here's my idea for rovers. Rovers are big things because they can take you around and show you places. See different kinds of rovers. NASA has been building some. We hope to see them roving on the moon, perhaps on Mars. This is mine that was designed for our school many years ago. You can pick up the paper on Google. I think it's called Mars Expedition. We had studied the idea of putting internal combustion engines working on methane, running around Mars on very long traverses. This is what I would do. If I had a chance, I'd load this up on a nuclear rocket ship and go down and traverse around here for a week and zoom back to planet Earth. These are some of the beautiful views we can see once you're on Mars. You know, Olympus Mons is special. Olympus Mons not only is the tallest volcano in our solar system, but the peak of it projects out into space because the atmosphere is so thin. The peak peaks out into space. Many things you could do in that. That's how big it is. And then the Valles Marineris, a very beautiful sight. Oh, I would love to do some fast rides on incredible vehicles. These appear in our report. And if you notice, right in the middle here, tiny up here, is the Helo, Ingenuity, that's flying on Mars now. This drawing was done in the year 1999. We knew they were going to fly these things. And guess what? It has changed the paradigm of how we explore Mars. This is Elon's idea for rocket ships. Don't ask me how he would land any of them so close to a city like this. My own feeling is that in anything we undertake on the extraterrestrial surfaces, be it the moon or Mars, we will do both surface structures and subsurface structures. Surface structures may be for scientific and economic development purposes, including a trade and manufacturing and so on. But people will tend to live underground where the where it's safe and where you're protected from the sun's harsh radiation. Anyone know who this is? This is Carter M. Art, one of my favorite artists, who's done a lot of work on Mars. I love people who draw. I suggest in your group of people who draw, and you want to draw till you get some incredible visuals. I love people who draw because when you draw, you learn what can go wrong and what are the merits and limitations of your design. This is why we prefer architects to engineers in the design and the execution of concepts. I'm being biased, but these are some of the views by Carter M. Art, who now resides in the National Galleries. I mean, he's the director there. And if you get a chance, get him to talk to you guys. Look at these beautiful imageries that really inspire. I mean, all that I did, all that I'm doing now, is inspiring. And I'm so glad that I'm able to do this for you all. I have had the pleasure of reading, and presenting. And before you know it, they put you in a spacesuit and you realize how terrible, how awful it is to be in a spacesuit for any length of time. I can tell you one thing for sure, the future is now. Robots are in your home right now. Robots are going to be in public, they're already in public places. They're already delivering pizzas at the university campus, and you can see them roaming around. Robots are going to take over in a big way. People call it artificial intelligence. I call it artificial help. And it's happening right now. So what does A.G. Wells say? In his Shape of Things to Come, he says, it is all the universe or nothing, which shall it be? I think it is the universe. And T.S. Eliot here in his Little Gidding, which is good reading for you all, says, we shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. This is what I think human spaceflight is about. Go out and finally realize, whoa, now we know what the limits of our wanton economic expansion on Earth is and how to live in harmony with nature. This is exactly what Buckminster Fuller, the father of space architecture, says. And more recently, about 10 years ago, somebody published a project called Planetary Boundaries, required reading for all of you. It tells you what is happening on planet Earth and how our species is probably messing up the balance of life. I think the native Indians call it Kuanakotsi. And when we go out into space, as we are all astronauts, as Buckminster Fuller says, we will become a more refined species. That is the most important philosophy for Earth, Earth dwellers, in my opinion. All of the aspects of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goal are ingrained in space activities. So we're coming to the end. We always deal, when you are looking at concepts, we are always looking at a deep philosophy at the bottom, provide, and from that evolve visions, and then we develop policies, and then little architects and engineers like me come and build concepts and engineering. It goes back to the philosophy for a check and say, is it a good thing or a bad thing? And then new visions come on. And I want you to think cyclically. Some interesting references for you. Take a look at them. There are some very interesting space architecture talks from people like Mark Cohen and others. This is an image I found in the Melodic Techno album that was posted on YouTube the other day. I thought this was cool. And as you know, just now, slides are being brought up from the James Webb Space Telescope. Take a look at the cosmos to see how big it is and the things that each of you will be able to do in the coming years as you become Mars, Moon and Mars architects. One of my favorite images comes from the Hubble, looking into Omega Centauri, one of those huge globular clusters that you can see in July, just rise up near Scorpius. think about it. These are places where we could go. These are probably places where people live. Unbelievable. Thank you. I have exactly 5 minutes for questions if they have some. Happy to take some. Nicole.
Hello, students. Thank you very much. Wonderful presentation. It's, close to my heart, this whole subject. And I love that you added the JWST picture and talked about there's probably civilizations out there. I love it very much. So students, if you have any questions, you can unmute yourself or type them in the chat. They've been a little shy, so that's okay.
Are they all from here, Nicole?
Or? They're from all over. The students are from all over the world, and some of the students are in a, you know, on the opposite side of the globe, so they watch the recording later, okay. So they're not all logged in at the same time.
Oh, good.
Any questions? I have a question. What I really like that you mentioned art and drawing out, you know, your ideas with engineering in mind. What would you recommend a student pursue, an art degree or an engineering degree, or engineering and do art on the side?
Well, you know, in my graduate studio, this is a secret sauce. If you want to quickly rise up to deliver an excellent product, you want to sharpen your pencils.
Yes.
You want to visualize. And then usually in a class of 15, there are two or three who are good artists. And I want to tell you something, Nicole, and to all of you. A good artist is an incredible mathematician.
You correct. Yeah, I agree.
You just don't know. And, you know, when somebody tells you that the proportion is wrong, she or he is conveying to you some of the most abstract mathematical concepts known to humanity. To quickly gauge and say, no, this is not correct.
They have a different spatial reason, spatial reasoning.
It is spatial reasoning, yep. And it's also intuitive reasoning, something yes. that we try to avoid when we want to convey messages to a large group of people. But then when you strike it, get it just right, a true artist is the highest mathematician. And I always believe that.
I agree. I actually am an artist and a scientist, and I'm very good at math. So I agree with all of that. Well, if there's no other questions, I really appreciate it. I enjoyed the talk very, very much. And it will reach out if we need any further assistance or mentorship.
Thank you all. And my good wishes to all.
Thank you.
I really want you to remember that space activity, particularly human space activity, is all about the imagination. It is the only faculty that distinguishes us from the rest of God's magnificent creatures.
And I agree.
We use it, and we want to use it to make us an even better species.
I agree completely.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Wonderful thoughts. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful day. Students, I will see you tomorrow.
All of you. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.